This reading is from the book, The Equanimous Mind, How a 10-Day Meditation Bootcamp Unexpectedly Awakened Me to the Fundamentals of Life and Existence, by Manish Chopra, as read by the author.
Day 6, Midlife Catapult. I had started wearing my watch to the meditation sessions as I felt that the distraction risk was much lower now that I was meditating continuously for an hour with my eyes closed. I have generally had a good quantitative sense for the passage of time, but not down to short increments, which became essential when every additional minute of pain endurance was precious and torturous. The number of people coming to the Dhamma hall for the 4:30 a.m. sitting had been dwindling as the days had progressed, perhaps because people were practicing in their rooms or saving their energies for the 3 mandatory 1-hour continuous meditation sittings. I knew that the returning students also had provisions to practice alternatively in their individually assigned shunyagar or solitary meditation cell in a separate area, preferring the isolated setting to practice when not otherwise required to be in the Dhamma hall. I had wondered whether new students would be given a taste of the meditation cells, or we might have to come back for a second course to experience the deeper solitary meditation opportunities. I happily settled for my comfortable spot in the Dhamma hall in the meantime and closed my eyes at 4:32 a.m. I had 2 goals for the session: to persist despite the pain in my right leg and lower back, and not to open my eyes until the full hour was over. It was not easy to clock an exact hour with one's eyes closed. I figured that I had a good instinctive estimation for half an hour, so all I would have to do is to count out twice that amount of time and would then be in good shape. During the meditation itself, my thoughts went to the realization of how lucky I was to have stumbled upon this great technique early enough in my lifespan to draw benefit from it in the years to come. So many stars had aligned perfectly: my wife's insistence over several years that I attend this course, her year-end vacation being shorter than mine, the special appeal of the executive version of the course, and the timing and location for the course fitting my India trip itinerary like a hand in glove. In hindsight, I was now glad that the timing had been delayed from my initial plan to attend the course in the summer, because I had several more pertinent life experiences in the intervening time that made for even more fertile ground on which to work on through the meditation practice. In all of this, the biggest motivating factor had been my wife. She would frequently look up potential course schedules and kept strategically synergizing them with other interesting travel plans I could make in conjunction with attending a Vipassana camp. It was also she who had found that an executive version of the course was offered in Mumbai, which had lowered the activation energy threshold for me to agree to register. Of all the other favorable confluence of events that enabled my participation, she had played the most proactive and vital part. She was the persevering influencer who had drawn the proverbial horse to the water. I had done well thus far in gulping down the benefits of the program in bucketfuls to quench my thirst for a better way to lead my life. My consciousness was suddenly overflowing with the surge of gratitude towards my wife, as I knew that an inherently skeptical and analytical soul like me wouldn't have come across something like Vipassana on my own. Even if I had, I wouldn't have given it a proper chance and would have rationally dismissed it without considering the possibility of its potential merit. I unexpectedly recalled that my wife would often ask me why I hadn't written any poetry since my years in college. Just as that thought popped into my head, did I find myself spontaneously working out some rhymes for a few couplets about her and our relationship, which were flooding into my mind with rapidity. I found it easy to come up with rhyming phrase after the next that captured the essence of our life together over the dozen years we had known each other. I wondered if this was happening mysteriously given how grateful I was feeling towards my wife, or because my mind was rekindling poetic expression, something that I had convinced myself had been a fluke blip during the romantic college years. It was like experiencing the inverse of the proverbial writer's block, if there was such a thing, with a flow of phraseology ranging from Shakespearean to the fanciful, yet otherwise unusable words I must have studied to prepare for the GRE test before applying to graduate school in the United States. What was even more remarkable was that these words were surfacing in my mind conjoined with interestingly humorous similes, metaphors, or juxtaposed together in clever phrases and witty expressions. While this might not be how Rushdie or Kafka would have felt about the quality of my spontaneous creativity, what I was experiencing was well beyond the impossible for the person that I had known myself to be for nearly 35 years. Carried away with all the poetic rhyming, I overshot the intended hour-long unsupervised sitting by a good 10 minutes. I was shaking with excitement when I walked into the dining hall for breakfast. I stacked up 4 idlis, steamed rice cakes, on my platter and poured 3 ladlefuls of sambar lentil curry over them, grabbed some coconut chutney and ketchup, and sat down quietly to eat in a corner. For the first time in nearly a week, I wanted to talk to someone and share what I was experiencing from the inside, as I was finding it hard to contain my enthusiastic testimonials. I went outside for a walk and the cool morning breeze swept a sense of calm over me. I felt happy and fortunate for my life and grateful to have finally heard the soft knock of the opportunity to liberate myself from the painful trappings of my old way of living. With a sense of confidence I had never experienced before, I felt that the days of self-doubt and self-loathing were behind me because I understood from first principles that I held the keys to my happiness in my hands. I had discovered that as long as I practiced maintaining an equanimous perspective that a self-observing, introspective meditation practice brings about, nothing external would have the power to perturb it. Goenkaji's reminder that mukti, or complete liberation, was not Siddhartha Gautama's, the Buddha's, soul monopoly started to make sense for the first time. Anyone, absolutely anyone, from a high-flying CEO to the head of a state to a blue-collared worker to a convicted criminal, had the right to and could learn to set their mind free of all misery should they choose to do so, with the right effort and understanding. Other unknowing people, as I once was, needed to know about the value and power of this technique, and I wanted to tell anyone and everyone I could about the benefits I had experienced from the meditation camp. How was I to do so? I was willing to go to lengths to deliver the message to whomever might give me an audience, if I had to, in order to invite others to benefit from the technique that had awakened me to the fundamental and universal principles of life and existence. Recognizing how off-centered and ignorant I had been before the camp, and yet having managed to draw some value from the experience, surely others who understood the principles better than I might embrace the benefits more easily. It quickly dawned on me that a potential avenue for me to share my before and after story was by writing about my experience once I returned from the camp. My hope was to build further awareness about this rediscovered technique and to encourage people to take the first step and attend an introductory Vipassana meditation camp. While I knew that sparing 10 days would be a significant deterrent for most, I remained hopeful that my unexpectedly positive and personally transformative experience might compel others to consider giving it a try if they could relate to the story. I started to feel that even if one more person drew benefit from learning to practice Vipassana, my effort to narrate my experience through words would be well worth it. Yet, I had no idea how I was going to go about writing a book, but knew that if I had a purposeful resolve, the path would emerge on its own. After all, I had spontaneously envisioned an internal consulting memoir and reconnected with the poet within. Surely, I could also share my experiences from the meditation camp if I put my mind to it. I didn't know the first thing about publishing a book, but felt confident that if I put my newfound creative energy towards it, nothing would be impossible. I remembered something a senior colleague had said in a speech during a training event for newly elected partners. If your dreams don't scare you, they are not big enough. I also remembered thinking at the time, the biggest dream I had was to become a successful entrepreneur after my career in consulting and then semi-retire as a professor at a top-tier university in my sunset years. Both dreams were lofty ones, but I had always considered them well within reach with my current skills and drive, thus never felt scared of these aspirations. Dreams of conveying a powerful message about a life-changing experience to one and all did seem a bit daunting, though something inside kept telling me it would be the right thing to do. Betraying this seemingly big new dream didn't seem like a sensible option, as it could mean consciously trying to muffle the vibrant flame of compassion and gratitude these few days had ignited in me. It was as if I needed to do this because the purpose of communicating the value of this technique, which had the prospect to rid so many other suffering souls of misery through their own effort and introspection, was so much bigger than me. I felt driven by a self-propelling and intensifying force from within to disseminate this powerful message, and my resolve to share the benefits of the technique with others grew stronger and stronger. For the first time, my dream did scare me a bit, but only because it wasn't something I had considered before in my wildest imagination, and not because I thought it wouldn't materialize because it couldn't be done. Pondering the positive changes I had been experiencing and the general value of introspective self-observation, self-awareness, and self-discovery, I gradually intuited that a lot of the world's greats must have known about the power and benefits of these meditative processes. They clearly had managed to imprint the knowledge of these universal principles onto their inner minds, whether through similar meditation techniques or some other practices leading to self-discovery. I recalled a quote from the famous book Man's Search for Meaning by Viktor Frankl, an unexpected and rare survivor from the Nazi concentration camps, that had stuck with me. Between stimulus and response, there is a space. In that space is our power to choose a response. In our response lies our growth and our freedom. Clearly, he had known that he would only feel tormented by his captors if his mind chose to accept and internalize the pain they were inflicting on him. Instead, despite any form of torture, however demeaning or physically brutal, his mind could tell itself that whatever his body or ego was experiencing was impermanent and it would eventually ebb away, as does everything else, and thus the mind could choose not to respond to any stimulus with a feeling of dejection or despair at its pitiable circumstances. What kept him alive when others around him, including close family members, were succumbing to their situation was a deeper purpose to live for, and thus the hope that he would make it out alive. The only way I could reason that he genuinely kept his hope alive and not faking it with wishful thinking was through knowing at a deeper fundamental level that unless his tormentors took his life with some brutality, whatever emotional and physical agony they were inflicting on him would only hurt him deep down into his consciousness if his mind gave permission to accept the pain being caused as a negative sensation and respond by wanting it to go away. So long as his spirit was unshattered and hopeful, his mind equanimous, any non-fatal harm to his physical body wouldn't weaken this resolve. Victor was pulled out of the camps, a mere skeleton with a veneer of skin on his body. People who saw him at the time said it was virtually impossible to have survived under the circumstances to which he was subjected. It finally made sense to me what Frankl meant when he said, "Is the power to choose our response." Having connected the dots on how Viktor Frankl emerged alive from the concentration camps, beating the odds, and how he chose to neutralize the agony he suffered, I noticed that the pain I had been experiencing in previous sittings in my lower back and right knee was virtually gone. I tuned in again to those same parts of my body to observe and consider what I was feeling in those areas, and all I could feel were the steady, uneventful surface conditions on the skin. I knew at this time in the sitting from my crude time estimation techniques that we were at least over 30 minutes into the session. Usually my right knee would have started throbbing in barely half that time and continue for the entirety of the hour, and the lower back pain would follow soon after, as if in sympathy, and move from the bottom upwards as the sitting progressed to engulf me with a blanket of pain all over my back until the sound of a nitya chant would ease the strain throughout my body. Something seemed off. Maybe while reflecting on Frankl's survival in the camps, I had stopped thinking about my knee and back pain. Wait, I stopped thinking about the pain and it went away? My chronic lower back pain disappeared because I wasn't actively focusing my mind's attention towards it? My scientific training kicked in, and I started analyzing how it might be possible that the physical pain I was experiencing had evaporated because my mental faculties had chosen to ignore it. I tried to piece together how we experience pain from fragments of junior high school biology that I could remember. If a body parts, or more precisely a biological cell's physical boundary is violated in any way, through a pinprick or pressure or shear or another kind of force, Its corresponding nerve sends off a signal to the brain. Once the brain receives a specific signal about the type of force and assesses the extent of the infraction, for example, how deep is the cut, it decides that it's time to experience that appropriate amount of pain and sends that message back to the injured or affected part of the body. Eureka! It's the brain that regulates the extent and experiencing of pain. Naturally, this is done involuntarily by our mind, or none of us in our right minds, unintended pun, would ever choose to experience an iota of pain, which is a neurobiological system designed to alert us to danger to our physical body. It's our inner mind that needs the rewiring to learn that all sensations, including pain, are transient so as not to avoid or bemoan them. Because the mind accepts the sensation of pain as something it doesn't want, the pain persists and continues to bother us. It would naturally be wrong to conclude that we should leave an open wound bleeding because every sensation is impermanent. While the pain is still transient, its role as a messenger of life-threatening and other serious ailment calls us to attend to the underlying source of unhealth in order to restore the body's well-being. How we orient our unconscious minds, once we can train and control it, will decide whether the mind treats the pain as transient or seemingly permanent. And depending on the orientation of the mind, the pain will last longer, seemingly indefinitely, or ebb away faster in its naturally cyclical manner. All this might not add up for the medically inclined, yet it was certainly what I substantiated through my experiments with the chronic pain in my back and knee, from which I had suffered for nearly 10 years since sustaining a fateful injury during a game of squash. Having concluded the pain experiment during the group sitting, I distinctly recalled one of my aunts telling me when I was gripped with pain immediately following my sports injury that I was thinking too much about my pain and she thought I would feel better if I stopped thinking about it. I had chuckled at that time at her lack of physiological understanding of the human body and had been slightly put off by her nonchalant suggestion that I could simply let go of feeling my pain by not focusing on it so much. Years later now, I finally nodded acknowledgement to the wisdom of what she had relayed very matter-of-factly at the time. She might not have known the neurobiological process for how the mind initiates, experiences, and regulates the sensation of pain, but probably had known from her personal experience that one can make pain subside or disappear by not thinking about it. One by one, many of life's mysteries, big and small, were revealing their secrets to me, and my admiration for those who had known them all along continued to grow. The mystery of how a man, any man, can ask someone who slaps him on one cheek to go ahead and hit him again on the other one also began to unlock itself. I had always appreciated Mahatma Gandhi's non-violence movement, but had wondered how he could accept a personal insult or injury and stay calm and not flinch. I understood now that the only way he could maintain an equanimous stance in the face of emotional and physical assault was if his mind chose not to let the ego feel hurt or let the body lament the physical pain the striker had caused through the act of aggression. Gandhi had also understood and known what Frankl had concluded and had exercised the choice of his response to remain equanimous as he faced his aggressors. Gandhi's equanimous response diffused their power to torment him and was how he brought the mighty British Empire down on its knees by protesting their oppression through skillful non-violent means. My third Adhitana sitting went by quickly in paying homage to those who understood the universal laws of life through their own experiences and experiments. I considered myself fortunate to at least have arrived at the school of self-discovering such knowledge, even if I had been living my life thus far unaware of and often in direct opposition to these principles. I could finally stop swimming countercurrent and fighting gravity now that I knew which side was the head of the stream, and thus having realized that water will always flow downhill no matter how hard you try to push it upwards. The conducting teacher announced at the end of the session that new students in successive batches would also be allotted meditation cells to practice in complete isolation should they wish to use them. I was elated to hear my name called out and I was assigned cell number 67 on the ground floor. It turned out that the enigmatic meditation cells were in a separate building, which was connected through a walkway over the roof of our main lodging quarters and accessible through a door at the rear end of the Dhamma Hall. Since we always entered the Dhamma hall barefoot, there was a separate set of slippers, numbered to match our assigned meditation cells to avoid confusion, placed neatly on a rack outside, together with some light umbrellas to facilitate the walk from the Dhamma hall to the solitary cells. I keenly followed the group of eager new students being escorted by one of the servers to the Ritz-Carlton of meditation suites available on campus. We all appeared especially exuberant because we were picked, probably alphabetically, but chose to believe it was based on some sort of merit, to be the first lot of new students to get the opportunity to use the cells. The only thing missing was a drum roll to accompany all the inner fanfare, at least as I was experiencing it. I walked through the concentrically circular chambers to find number 67, which was a corner cell, and I liked the look of it from the outside. I gently opened the door and noticed a lizard zip right through the front wall and flash off to the adjacent cell, which seemed connected near the ceiling, probably to facilitate ventilation. I distinctly noticed that I was a lot less startled by the sight of an unseemly lizard than I would have otherwise been before joining the meditation camp. I sat down on a similar looking cushion to the ones as in the Dhamma hall and started to make myself comfortable. There were a couple of smaller extra cushions lying nearby, probably to place underneath the legs to make the cross-legged posture more comfortable for long sittings. I then flicked on the light switch to the low wattage lamp in the room, which gave a nice touch to the full-service meditative suite. Just as I closed my eyes to start concentrating on the sensations at the crown of my head, the pounding sounds of hammers started from up above, and it felt like the whole cell was reverberating from the repeated impact. I had noticed some scaffolding above the cells as we were entering, and had looked up and seen some workers completing the construction of the dome of the pagoda building that housed the solitary meditation cells. Knowing that the slightest sounds, especially when caught unawares by them, would easily unsettle me and spring me out of my seat, I started to consider how I could possibly meditate with such intense ambient noise. Sighting the lizard earlier had also been on my mind, though less so than the chiseling and hammering workers. I stayed put for another 10 minutes, thinking I would manage to numb out the exterior environment once I got into the meditative zone, but it just wouldn't work. I stepped out of my cell and slowly made my way outwards in awe of those who were managing to concentrate despite the same loud noise and started walking back towards the Dhamma hall. The inner sanctum and the concentrically organized cells in the chamber gave it the feel of a typical monastery from what I had seen in history book pictures, not having visited one myself. I ran into one of the more stern-looking servers on the way back, who gently asked if I was encountering any difficulties as he saw me walk back without spending any real time in my newly allotted cell. I ashamedly admitted to feeling distracted by the construction noise and told him I might return in the afternoon if the workers were taking a break at that time. The quiet expression in his eyes seemed to convey, "Forgive them, for they know not what they do," as he peacefully slanted his head to one side and let me depart, feeling somewhat less guilty. I now felt badly about the fact that I was part of the first batch of meditation cell allottees amongst the new students, and had taken the opportunity away from another student who might have been comfortable practicing meditation in the cell with the construction noise in the background. I couldn't muster the courage to approach the conducting teacher to reassign the cell to someone else, because that might also convey that I had no future interest in using the cell, which had seemed like a real privilege only a short while ago. I had felt quite content with practicing in the comfortably open Dhamma hall, which had continued to grow on me over the days. I also hadn't found my sleeping room a conducive setting for meditation because of too many distractions, chief among which was the inviting sight of the bed. Discouraged by my unspectacular debut at meditating in the solitary cell, I promptly lined up to ask the conducting teacher about my sensitivity to light, sound, and animals in the post-lunch Q&A period. He patiently explained that we all possess the power of patient tolerance, which enables us to withstand external stimuli, but it can sometimes become suppressed because of events in our lives. He suggested that I might be able to reawaken the power to tolerate such stimuli more calmly in 4 to 6 months if I kept up my meditation practice, especially towards light and sound, the sensitivity towards animals usually being more deep-seated and would likely take longer to recalibrate. Memories of childhood when I was traumatized by a large furry dog and the year of hazing rituals in high school where we always slept semi-conscious and on high alert, ready to fend off senior students who might surprise us with a bucket of cold water or worse pranks when fast asleep in our bunk beds flashed through my mind. I felt encouraged that I might one day be able to please my wife by letting her continue to read or watch television when I wanted to go to sleep and not have to ask for a completely quiet and dark room to doze off at night. I managed a short sitting in the Dhamma hall before retiring to my sleeping room to get some rest before the afternoon Adhitana sitting. Lying in bed, I reflected on the fact that I'd always wanted to write and perhaps find a way to publish a book. Never before could I find the idea or courage or time to overcome the initial inertia. It now seemed as if the idea for the first book for company colleagues was a warm-up for the next one that had a more universally compelling and far-reaching message. It was also reassuring that in case I had thought that finding the inspiration to plan one book in a short window of time was perhaps a fluke, developing the idea for a second one simultaneously certainly cleared any doubt from my mind that the unexpected surge in creative expression, heightened self-awareness, and other positive changes were in fact very real and thus likely to sustain beyond the initial euphoric state at the camp. A sense of purpose was driving me from the inside to establish goals that were both unimportant and inconceivable even a few days ago, in a way I had never experienced before. The last thing I would have expected going into a Vipassana meditation camp was that I would be contemplating writing two books coming out of it. I chuckled, thinking that perhaps these creative ideas were flooding my mind because this was the only way I could express myself under a strict code of silence for 10 days. For someone as constantly switched on as I was used to being day in and day out, the unending barrage of thoughts had to find an outlet somehow. This somewhat cynical pseudoscientific theory still couldn't explain the reactivated memory and vocabulary. The afternoon group sitting was rather uneventful as most of us were getting increasingly accustomed to sitting continuously for the full hour with lessening discomfort. However, the ongoing Adhitana sittings had certainly driven a few more students to other more comfortable locations or sitting arrangements, and I wondered whether those students had also arrived at the same conclusions as I'd had about self-regulable pain management having persisted through the pain in my unchanged position. After a few cycles back and forth from head to toes and back, I spent a few extra minutes in the head and face where I would typically experience more sensations. My theory was that the majority of the sensory organs, eyes, ears, nose, mouth, are all planted in our head and face, so by definition the sensory experience is more pronounced in that region. When I raised this with him sometime later, the conducting teacher's simple retort was that after all, the body's computer was located inside our head, so we naturally experience the sensations best closest to the transmission receiver's location. After a thorough scanning of the head, as I moved past the neck and throat to my shoulders, I suddenly felt that the sensations I was feeling in my shoulders were a good feet or two below where I sensed my head was situated. I could almost pinpoint down below with my mind to the various points in my torso and limbs. It was a completely surreal feeling of physical detachment and experiencing for the first time that my mind was clearly dissociable from my body. In some hard-to-express outer-body, mind-over-matter kind of way, it also helped me rationalize that the pain I had previously been experiencing in my back and right knee perhaps wasn't really happening to me and was simply another phenomena that I was observing. I was late to the dining hall for the evening tea and snack and noticed that the only food item left was cut papaya, which was always in ample supply at breakfast and tea time. The self-explanatory look from the server who was coordinating the meal conveyed that the kitchen was out of any other fruits or snacks. I'd probably tasted papaya all of 3 times in my life and I had always had to overpower its aftertaste with some other more palatable food item. I estimated that if I didn't consume anything with tea, I would have to go without eating for over 18 hours between lunch from earlier in the day and breakfast the following morning, and wasn't sure if my body was quite ready to handle such extended and unexpected fasting. I formulated a plan to gobble up a few pieces of papaya, purely for its nutritive value, and douse it quickly with some black ginger tea. As the first cut piece of the fruit touched my palate and slowly melted in my mouth, I could hardly believe I was enjoying the taste of papaya, which I had decided to eat purely out of desperation and lack of an alternative form of nourishment. Though it's possible that all the other papaya I'd ever tasted in the past were genuinely distasteful, knowing myself well, I knew the more realistic explanation was that my mind had overcome an ill-formed prejudice which was likely based on limited and biased information in the first place. Evening group meditation was uneventful aside from the fact that I opened my eyes 10 minutes before the designated hour was up as a wave of impatience surged through me. I promised myself that this would be the only sitting in which I broke the adhyatana and managed to do so for the rest of the program. It was interesting that my patience wore out more easily in a timed session on the same day I had overshot an untimed session by 10 minutes earlier that very morning. I reconciled this by thinking that those two sessions averaged each other out and settled myself down after a short break to follow the next day's instructions. The overall procedure remained the same, except we were now to scan symmetric body parts, for example, eyes, ears, limbs, together in pairs when sequentially stepping through the body to experience sensations back and forth from head to toes. The evening discourse started with the reminder that effectively only 3 full days were left for real practice of Vipassana, as we would be breaking the noble silence on the morning of the 10th day, which would make practicing meditation that day much harder. The theme for the day's discourse was oriented towards highlighting the 5 hindrances, or enemies as they were described, to maintaining a steady meditation practice, especially after we left the camp. These obstacles in turn were cravings, aversions, mental and physical laziness, agitation and skepticism. In different ways, these forces would try to get in the way and we must find our own way to overcome each of them and continue to stay the course and find time to practice. We were encouraged to remain aware and equanimous every moment, regardless of whatever sensation we were experiencing, and to train the mind to experience that all sensations are transient. Goenkaji drew the analogy of how a walking trail, which was once well known, can become covered with undergrowth and infested with snakes and other reptiles if people stop treading on it. Later, if people refer to having knowledge of the route only in conversation or imagination, it doesn't amount to the same thing as knowing how to traverse it. If someone would subsequently attempt to go down the same track, they would quickly get discouraged by the hardship in locating a clearly visible path, and would come back to report that the path actually no longer existed and would discourage others from attempting to follow it. Much in the same way, the practice of Vipassana became extinct from the Indian subcontinent as people stopped following it earnestly over time. He highlighted that several other sages like Nanak, Mahavir, and Kabir seemingly understood the concept of Vipassana through their own experiences, as can be intuited from their teachings and verses. Interestingly, I had concluded the same must have been true for modern-day sages like Frankel and Gandhi earlier in the same day. These greats had understood the universal life processes and concepts through their self-discoveries and introspective first-hand experiences, even though they weren't active practitioners of Vipassana who could teach the technique to others. Similarly, references to the underlying concepts of impermanence and understanding or experiencing truth by observation can also be found in several ancient Indian texts like the Rig Veda or the Bhagavad Gita, but their associated experiential knowledge had largely been reduced to reciting the scriptures with little recognition or attention to the in-depth meaning they intended to convey. I came back to my room and lay flat on my back and concluded there was absolutely no way I could go back to living the same way I did before I had come upon Vipassana. All these years of learning how to be a talented engineer, a good son, brother, husband, an analytical researcher, and lately an effective consultant, I had missed out on the most important learning of all, how to live life, in a peaceful and purpose-filled manner. I felt as if I was being reborn, a new mind and conscience in the same physical form, and was getting a chance to lead a more meaningful and balanced life.
Pariyatti, a non-profit 501c3 organization, offers a wide variety of books, eBooks, videos, and audiobooks about the teachings of the Buddha, the Pali language, and Vipassana meditation. Browse our complete catalog at www.pariyatti.com. pariyatti.org.